Greetings once again, our dear listener, and I greet in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to our new lesson quarter, adult Sabbath school study. And today we are doing lesson number one, and we are on the book of Mark. The book of Mark. And this lesson will take us July, August, and September 2024. I welcome you once again to this, again, another amazing study from that of the Great Controversy. And today we are going to look at the beginning of the Gospel. The beginning of the Gospel. Remember, we are dealing with the book of Mark. And our memory text is from the book of Mark chapter 1, verse 14 and 15. And the Bible says, "Now after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.'" Dear friend, as we are diving into this amazing lesson, may we have a word of prayer. Loving Father, who dwells in the Most High, we thank you very much, and we pray for your guide and lead. Guide us in all. In Jesus' name I pray and believe. Amen and amen. The beginning of the gospel. And we see a question comes in our lesson, and there is asking, who wrote the book of Mark? And relating here and there, we find out that really, this book does not mention who clearly or who surely wrote the book of Mark or the Gospel of Mark. But reading in all and relating the books, as the Bible tells us that here a little and there a little, we relate here and there, then we get what is the real point. From the times, each of the canonic gospels has been associated with either an apostle, that's Mark and John, or with a companion of an apostle. For example, the Gospel of Luke is linked with Paul, and the Gospel of Mark is linked with Peter. And here, it is where I pick a leaf. And we see that though the author of Mark never gives his name in the text, there is nowhere you can read in the book of Mark, but the early church tradition indicates that the author of the Gospel of Mark was John Mark, a sometime traveling companion of Paul and Barnabas, as we shall read in Acts chapter 13, and also a later an associate of Peter. So we see that the book of Mark was written by John Mark, as we shall see as we continue in the lesson. So, as we dive in this lesson for this week, we need to understand who really Mark is and who really John Mark was, who wrote the gospel, and then go through the life of Jesus Christ as we're starting his mission. This leads me to Pat Sandy, and Pat Sandy is entitled "The Failed Missionary." This just brought some laughed at me, "The Failed Missionary." You know, when time came, when we read in the book of Acts chapter 12, verse 12, Acts chapter 12, verse 12, the Bible says, "And when he had considered the thing, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many were gathered together praying." Here we are seeing Mark being mentioned, or the name of his surname. The other name was called John. And we see that this seems the Mark that wrote the book of Mark. This verse, which introduces a prayer meeting that was conducted in the house of the mother to John Mark, we see the story of Peter's escape from the prison. And also we see the subsequent actions and the death of Herod are replete with striking, even humorous contrasts between Peter and the king. Now, John Mark does not really play any role in the story, but the introduction of him at this point prays for his lighter connection with Barnabas and Saul. That's why you see that he is mentioned in the book of Acts, but you see that there is no much connection therein. And when we come to chapter 13 of Acts, verse 1 through 5, and verse 13, this verse speaks about Mark, and it speaks about the missionary journeys that were taken by Barnabas and Paul. But we see that Acts chapter 13 describes the first missionary journey of Saul and Barnabas, starting about AD 46. And we see that John Mark here is not mentioned until we come to verse 5. And his role is simply as a helper or a servant, with helping these Paul and Barnabas as they went to the field. But we see that no other reference is made to the young man until verse 13. And we see that in verse 13, we see him giving up. He said, he can no longer go. Wow. And we see that the difficulties that were accompanied is the missionary work. They made John Mark leave and go back for home. And we see that this young man surely gave up and went back. And that's where we pick the Pharaoh missionary. He had come to help in the missionary work, but things failed. The difficulties were very many. Then he had to go and leave the work. Leave it any there. Part Monday, it gives us a title of the second chance. Now here we see that when Paul saw that this younger man went, actually when we read in the book of Acts chapter 15 verse 38, it reads, but Paul thought not good to take him with them, who departed from them from Amphipolis, and went not with them to the work. Mark, at first he departed and he didn't go with them. Then here comes the time that he wanted to join the flock, the missionary again, or the mission. But Paul saw that, no, I cannot go with this gentleman because of the first action that happened. For he left them and he went. So here we see that now Barnabas takes up the cross and then he said, I will go with Mark. And Saul had to choose Silas, and we see them parting. Paul went with Silas, and then Barnabas went with Mark. But we see that this second chance that was given to this younger man, that's John Mark, he comes again, and then he was reformed. What a wonderful statement that Paul makes about Mark. In the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 11, the Bible says, only Luke is with me. Take Mark and bring him with thee, for he is profitable to me for the ministry. Wow! These were almost 15 to 20 years after the transformation, or after the transforming power has done something through this young man, John Mark. Now Paul tells Timothy, come with Mark, for he is profitable to me in the ministry. Think about it. The second chance that was given to this Mark, it made him to be transformed. How many times do you consider many of those who act as if they are failed? But again, if you give them a second chance, they can revive and do more better. That is needed. A lesson to pick today. The second chance that was given to Mark by Barnabas made him to be transformed. And even Paul now praises him. Dear friend, John Mark starts the book and starts the message. Great. to the people that are living and to those that were there at that time. And this leads me to Part Tuesday, which speaks about the messenger. Part Tuesday, it opens up with the scriptures from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 1 through 8. And these scriptures mentions and speaks about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and speaks about God the Father, and also speaks about John the Baptist. And as they open up, we see that this still, John, Mark, quotes some words from the book, from the Old Testament. And these words can help us learn more about what he was bringing in us. Now, when you see John Mark in the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 2 through 3, he quotes some words, which is a blending from the book of Exodus, chapter 23, verse 20, and from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verse 3, and from the book of Malachi, chapter 3, verse 1. Now, the book of Exodus, chapter 23, verse 20, refers to an angel that God will send before Israel to bring them to Canaan. And Isaiah, chapter 40, verse 3, it speaks of God appearing in the wilderness with a highway prepared before him. And then Malachi, chapter 3, speaks of a messenger going before the Lord to prepare his way. And all these three passages speak of a journey. We see that Mark is building a gospel about Jesus Christ. And when we see his writing from the start, we see that he is speaking of something or about a journey. And as we continue, we see that the text in Isaiah, it has many ties with the ministry of John the Baptist. That is the messenger who came to prepare a way before the Lord comes. And it also focuses on the way of the Lord. In the Gospel of Mark, we see that the resonator writer tells us that the Lord Jesus is on a journey. When you read the Gospel of Mark, we see Jesus Christ on the journey. So we see his way prepared by John, and then after there he comes, after John has prepared the way. And in keeping with the quotation from the Old Testament in the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 2 and 3, John the Baptist calls for repentance, a turning away from sin, and a turning back to God. That's Mark chapter 1, verse 4. Clothed like the ancient prophet Elijah, you can compare that with 2 Kings chapter 1, verse 8. He speaks in Mark chapter 1, verse 7 and 8 about the one coming after him who is mightier than he. Dear friend, this will lead me to Part Wednesday. Part Tuesday speaks about John the Baptist as a messenger. Part Wednesday, it comes with Jesus' baptism. Remember now we have known that Mark is making or is writing a journey of Jesus Christ, how he came and how he moved. Now, we see Jesus' baptism in the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 9 through 13. We see John baptized Jesus Christ. In the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 11, a voice came and it says, "You are my beloved son, with you I am well pleased." After Jesus being baptized, the heavens opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him like a dove. And then a voice came, "You are my beloved son, with you I am well pleased. From there, events now start happening. Jesus is led in the wilderness after his baptism, and this was the start of his ministry. He is drove by the Holy Spirit. And when he was drove by the Holy Spirit, he went there where Satan is there and then met him and started tempting him. But Jesus won all the temptation, the struggles that he went through, all the lack of the agony, the suffering that happened to him. And we see that the book of Mark brings us something when it is starting. We see that it shows us Jesus's divinity and also Jesus's humanity. Listen, Jesus's divinity, he is called Christ, the Messiah, in Mark chapter 1, verse 1. The Lord announced by a messenger, Mark chapter 1, verse 2 and 3. Mightier than John, Mark chapter 1, verse 7. The beloved Son of whom the Spirit descends, Mark chapter 1, verse 10 and 11. But on the other side, where we see the humanity coming in, we see that he is baptized by John, Mark chapter 1, verse 9. He is driven by the Spirit, Mark chapter 1, verse 12. Tempted by Satan, Mark chapter 1, verse 13. With the wild animals, Mark chapter 1, verse 13. And we see that angels minister to him. That's Mark chapter 1, still verse 13. These two, all these points, shows us that Jesus was divine and Jesus was human. Taking all that, we see that Jesus Christ, him coming to this world, he came to save. And as he came to save, these points help us understand and know that he is Christ in reality. He is our Lord. He is our Savior. He is our God. And yet, also a human being. How? He is our brother. He is our example. The pattern that we need to live for is through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ gave us the example not to live because someone, or a pastor, a missionary, evangelist, a brother, sister, they are living like this, but Jesus gave us a pattern how we can live. Dear friend, we need to know and learn more of Jesus, how he was baptized, and of the journey that he went through. That journey can help us to be strengthened, to be courageous, to move on, that we wait upon him, that he can give us the best that we need. Someone who created you, someone who made me, made you out of the dust, gave us the breath, into our spirit, we gained such a soul that we are living. He came down here to save us and die for you, and die for you. Think about the agony he went through. Think about all that was done just because he needed to save me and you. Dear friend, the gospel according to Jesus, that's part Thursday, in Mark chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, the Bible says, now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. The gospel, according to Jesus Christ, is now speaking about the time being fulfilled. And we see that this gives a summary in the book of Mark for the simple and direct message of Jesus. And in its three parts, as illustrated, we see that there is a time prophecy that time was fulfilled when Jesus was speaking about it. And there was a covenant promise that the kingdom of God was near or is near. And there is a call to discipleship, that is to repent and believe the gospel. In the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 24 through 27, it speaks about this time. And this time is the 70 weeks. And this 70-week prophecy, which finds its fulfillment in the baptism of Jesus, where he is anointed with the Holy Spirit, as you can study that prophecy, and begins his ministry, as we can see in Acts chapter 10, verse 38. In this prophecy, one day stands for air, as we have been studying this in the Great Controversy. As we can see in Numbers chapter 14, verse 34, Ezekiel chapter 4, verse 6. And we see that the prophecy began in 457 BC with the decree that was given by King Artaxerxes to restore Jerusalem. And we see that completing of the work of restoration of Jerusalem in Ezra chapter 7, you can see that. We see that now 69 prophetic weeks would extend to AD 27. That's where we see Jesus' baptism and anointing with the Holy Spirit. Then we also see the commence of his ministry. AD 27, Jesus got baptized, Jesus was anointed, and Jesus started his ministry. His crucifixion would take place 3.5 years later. And then we see that finally, the completion of the 70th week would occur in AD 34, where we see that the Jews stoned his disciple, and that's Stephen. When they stoned him, they were like saying, "We don't want your gospel." So the gospel now was to be spread to the whole world. And we see the gospel starting, going there and there, even me, Uganda, even you, where you are, you've gotten the gospel. And it is now moving there and there. The gospel according to Jesus Christ, time of prophecy was fulfilled. Covenant promise. Jesus is coming soon. God's kingdom is on the road. Call to discipleship. We need to repent and believe the gospel. That only can save us. Dear friend, as you look on the world is developing, running, its movements are going so fast. Things are happening that we cannot even tell. You need to think about your life. Life does not only end where we are. There are very many things, amazingly, that we can do. Very many of them. But dear friend, only a life in Christ Jesus can give you peace. Think about the death that is happening each and every time. You're not so special that you're living today. And dear friend, check yourself as I check myself. Each and every time. God so loved the world that he gave us his only begotten Son, that whoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. That scripture is the hope that we have. If we don't believe in him, then we shall perish, for the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is everlasting life through Jesus Christ, who died for you, who died for me, that you can be saved. Dear friend, I tell you, if you need to go back and study the agony that Jesus went through to only save you and save me, you need to do so. I recommend to you the book Deserved Ages. If you can get it, whether soft copy or hard copy, try to read it. If you cannot afford that one, find the book of John, read the book of John, the gospel, read it on your own pace, I know you'll pick something. Don't forget to share with friends the message that we always get. May we have that offering. Loving Father of the Master, we thank you very much for your perfect day and me. Lead us in all and be with us. In Jesus' name I pray and believe. Amen. Amen. See you on our second lesson. Bye bye.